In this post-Harvey Weinstein world, it didn't take long for Capitol Hill to become a focal point for its own sexual harassment scandals. One example, the sitting senator who is facing groping allegations from four women. Al Franken, the Democrat from Minnesota, has issued three written apologies now, but he hasn't disputed that these incidents actually happened. His Thanksgiving Day statement read this way, "I crossed a line for some women, and I know that any number is too many. Some women have found my greetings or embraces for a hug or photo inappropriate, and I respect their feelings about that. I feel terribly that I've made some women feel badly, and for that, I am so sorry, and I want to make sure that never happens again." Then there's Congressman John Conyers, accused of harassment and discrimination by former staffers. He's facing an ethics investigation after BuzzFeed first reported he used taxpayer dollars to settle a 2015 complaint from a former staffer who alleges that she was fired because she refused sexual advances from the congressman. Conyers denies the harassment allegations, but even some members of his own party are calling for him to resign.
Enough is enough at this point. What I am voicing publicly is what every single private citizen is saying across America. Why are the rules for politicians in Washington different than they are for everyone else? Right now, what we're talking about is there going to be any level of accountability? And, you know, saying that we're going to have these allegations against politicians go before an ethics committee that can sometimes take a couple of years, no offense to my colleagues who are on the ethics committee, but that's not real. That's not real. And that's not accountability.
And Molly, she's out front and in many ways alone on this, with most folks saying it should go to the ethics committee, some people saying that he should step down from his positions on different committees. How does Congress move forward on this? What do they do?
Yeah, I think this is a real moment of reckoning to see if Congress can actually handle this within their own ranks or if they will be, you know, able to see the misdeeds among everybody else but not their own. I mean, this is clearly, there is already a move that has some support to change the way these allegations are handled. The Conyers case, you could see how flawed that process was. I guess nobody should be surprised that the people who write the rules make the rules to favor them.
Right.
Mm-hmm. That's the case in many areas involving politicians. But as Congresswoman Rice was saying, this is a process that seems set up to protect members of Congress instead of to protect the alleged victims of these kinds of behavior. And so there's a move to change what had been a confidential process that really put victims at a disadvantage. But I don't think that's going to be enough for a lot of people. I think a lot of people are going to want to see, as Congresswoman was saying, some actual consequences and to see this handled in what doesn't feel like a partisan manner. If this becomes, you know, this is the other team's problem and the people on my team are blameless, that is going to, I think, really put a bad taste in people's mouth, really seem hypocritical.
And along with Representative Rice there, the Detroit Free Press, their editorial board has called on Representative Conyers to resign. They said the revelations of Conyers' alleged sexual harassment scandal and his documented use of taxpayer dollars to bury that scandal in violation of congressional ethics rules is less ambiguous. It is the kind of behavior that can never be tolerated in a public official, much less an elected representative of the people. That is their take on it. Very hard to get people to resign. And leaders in some ways may not be as powerful as they once were. And you talk about somebody like Conyers. He's 88 years old, longest serving member in the House and one of the founders of the CBC. He is saying he's not going anywhere.
I mean, yes, ultimately it's up to Conyers because the process to actually remove somebody is either there's a very high political hurdle, as we see when we're talking about Roy Moore and whether there'll be votes to expel him, or it just takes a very long time for the Ethics Committee to do its due diligence and go through the process and listen to everybody on both sides. And so, yeah, the leaders do not have as much power as they'd like to have if a member just wants to stick to their seat. And this is why you're seeing it, you know, play out the way it is. But I want to take issue with one thing that the Congresswoman Rice said, which is that she's saying, why are the rules for politicians in Congress different from everybody else? They're not. Right now, this system is not like it's perfect for every waitress in America or everybody who works in a corporation. Right now, we're having, yes, Harvey Weinstein lost his company, basically, on the basis of this. And now the spotlight has shifted to Congress, and they do need to change their own rules to be able to get some credibility. But what they're actually going to need to be doing in doing that is setting an example for the rest of the country. Because right now, there is nothing that actually protects the average blue collar, white collar, what have you, every person. And so you kind of need this to go a certain way in order to start having that discussion and at the non-glittering, non-Hollywood, you know, center of government D.C. level, which is the next stage of where this needs to go, if this is going to be a problem.
And Congresswoman Dingell agrees with you, and here's what she had to say about the climate on Capitol Hill and how they have a chance to lead.
There are more names coming. There's no question. I've heard them for years. And any man that has practiced just despicable and irresponsible behavior needs to be worried. Congress needs to lead on passing legislation that holds people accountable, doesn't make the taxpayers pay for it, has everybody pay for it, and is transparent.
And Lauren, we'll see some movement maybe next week in terms of legislation coming up on the Hill.
Right. And already on Capitol Hill, you know, they have voted to have mandatory sexual harassment training. It's kind of incredible that that wasn't required before on Capitol Hill. But I think what we're going to be seeing moving forward is as these ethics investigations unfold, like the Congresswoman said, they can take years. This is not going away. The spotlight is not going away. And I think we're going to continue to see legislation moving forward.
And in terms of the consequences for 2018, if you flash back to the year of the woman in 1992, kind of it was a result of a lot of the conversation that we're having now about sexual harassment, that time involving Clarence Thomas. Some numbers in terms of women wanting to run. We've got some from the Center for American Women in Politics. And it shows that there does appear to be something of a surge. In 2018, 354 potential female candidates. That's up from 181. In 2016, U.S. Senate, 38 potential candidates, up from 19. This could have some sort of effect at the ballot box in terms of enthusiasm and how women vote and how they run.
Yeah, I do think that is sort of an optimistic view right now, just in the terms of where we are broadly as a culture and sort of the minute-by-minute news cycle to think that we'll be talking about this still in November. Although, that said, it is certainly a cultural moment right now. This has lasted through several news cycles. The Washington Post reporter who broke the Charlie Rose story was on television talking about her reporting. This is a story she started reporting 7 years ago and couldn't get it out because she was hitting dead ends that women didn't want to talk. Now, fast forward to the current climate, and these women are more willing to talk. And regardless of where this debate goes, it needs to go further. But that at least is a positive sign right now. If women are more willing to talk about this and to say that this isn't acceptable, it's a baby step. And electorally, what the effect this will have in November, let's see what effect it has in Alabama.
Right.
I mean, you know, Trump won Wisconsin.
Corinne, so you seem like you want to cut in here.
I was saying Alabama may not be the greatest litmus test for the entire country in this particular regard. I mean, if Roy Moore gets elected, you might actually see more of a backlash to that in other states because they find that so that doesn't sit well in other places that may not have as much of a bond with the candidate. I mean, it seems like a lot of people in the GOP have a bond with Roy Moore. They may not be, and there's the question of, are the polls that are showing that Moore is behind actually accurate? Because are people going to say, yes, I'm going to vote for Roy Moore the same way they might do that in a secret ballot, right? So if he gets in, that could actually fuel the Year of the Woman thing more than it being, you know, the litmus test for is it going to work or is it not? But again, it depends on what happens then, and then who else is campaigning and how the conversation goes in those places.
It'll be fascinating to watch. Still ahead, Michael Flynn's lawyers in communications with Team Trump. What the change could mean for the Russia investigation. The lines of communication between Donald Trump's and Michael Flynn's lawyers are now closed. The former National Security Advisor's legal team isn't sharing information with Team Trump anymore, a source familiar with the matter told CNN. The source says the move could indicate that Flynn is preparing to plead guilty in the Mueller investigation. Trump's lawyers, Jay Sekulow, put out a statement saying, not so fast. No one should draw the conclusion that this means anything about General Flynn cooperating against the president. Karen, what do you make of this new revelation? It came out last week, no longer cooperating. Some people jumping to conclusions, other people saying not so fast, like Sekulow there.
Well, look, there's Flynn has been a big question mark for a long time. He approached the congressional committees, and there was talk about, you know, was he going to be asking for immunity in order to testify? Did that mean he had something to say? No, yes, we weren't sure. That was months ago. More recently, we've seen that, you know, that the his work for Turkey has working the lobbying that he did, that
right.
he was paid for, that wasn't directly for Turkey, but was for advocating for certain positions. And then there's this report about whether he was trying to take money in order to get Gulen extradited. And again, this gets into Turkish politics, but it's significant because the thing that brought Manafort into Mueller's crosshairs was not necessarily something that is directly related to the Trump campaign. It was the lobbying, the work that he did, that he had that over his head. That is actually, like, he broke the law in that sense, is what Mueller's alleging. If he's moving in similar territory on Flynn, that means Flynn has to worry about himself in a way that may be more critical, frankly, than whatever he knows or can say about the president. So is this a question of pleading guilty? We don't know. Is it pleading guilty to anything involving
right.
the collusion probe? Maybe not, right? But Mueller's probe is very, very broad. And if he has Flynn on something else that is, you know, a do-or-die situation for Flynn, he could very easily say this is the time to talk. And then, you know, he only complicates his own position if he continues to talk with the president. The more that they talk, the more there is that frankly, the more the president is in danger, too, if Flynn is actually a focus of Mueller where something is going to happen, something's going to crack if he's the next person.
And at least...
So, frankly, the separation, in a way, could protect both of them, but also... Flynn has been in a situation where people have been looking at him like he has something to say, and we know that he now has this albatross around
right.
his neck
yeah.
for what he did that is separate.
Yeah, and at least one Republican saying the White House should be worried.
I would be concerned if I were perhaps in the White House. So when families are involved, you know, people are going to do what they have to do to protect themselves and their families. And so I don't know that anybody should feel particularly comfortable right now. I would not be very relaxed.
And the family that's involved here is Jared Kushner. He's going to have to turn over some more documents of the Senate committee this next week coming up by Monday, I believe. And we've also, there have been two big stories about him where he's sort of saying, I'm laying low, I'm Bennett and not in it in the way that I used to be. Used to be the secretary of everything, sort of the secretary of nothing at this point. What did you make of some of the, and there were the headlines from the Times and the Washington Post. What did you make of those stories?
Well, Kushner gave an interview for the Washington Post one, and he validated.